there on the bay. Greetings. This is our Tuesday show. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Today's talk is focused on three topics. The first topic is Tesla's SpaceX challenge. The second talk focuses on Autopilot 2 and sort of the whys and what's going on there. And the third issue is what we call the robot revenge. Tesla is now trying to crowdsource solution. Great idea there, Jerry. That does. Thank you, Jerry, for the heads up on that. So, greetings. Please note, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. If this is your first time on our channel, please take time to like and subscribe and hit the bell icon so you don't miss anything. If you're a repeat visitor, welcome back. Please also note we put a couple of ads in, and this plane may not allow me to speak fully, but we do put a couple of ads in. It's helpful if you watch at least 5 or 10 seconds of it to support our channel. And also, please note that your like is actually a big deal. It impacts a great deal how we're ranked, and would be appreciative of your taking time to like and subscribe as well if you particularly like what we've covered. So also note, thanks for the note, Jerry. We tend to wait until the end of our show before we respond, and many of our viewers not watching live will actually find us there. So welcome back. We weren't expecting to be on this week on Tuesday because we've been doing more shows than usual. Our usual schedule a month is Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday. And so we'll have another show coming on Thursday of this week, and look forward to, if possible, having your visiting with us. So today's sort of startup, I just wanted to note I'm in a place called Alexandria, Virginia, and sort of out of the right corner there, you can see what's called the Wilson Bridge. So I'm in a water area, and I, as I usually do with my shows, I go to sort of my nature scene of where I'm at afterwards. Mm-hmm. So look forward to you guys checking this out. The next thing that I'd like to, first thing I'd like to cover is what I call the Tesla NASA SpaceX challenge. So what this is about is the fact that when the space program first started, and you'll notice because we're in the flight path, I'll try to slow down my comments when a land is occurring and then get back to it. So what happened is that NASA and the builders of the space program found that there was a problem that happened, which is if you have a computer and you have software, the two of them will run for 100,000 iterations correctly, and then there'll be something that goes wrong. And the problem is they can't figure out why it is this occurred. So the solution they came up with was to have three identical computers made by IBM, and then two of them would run on IBM software, one of them would run on Sperry software. And so if one computer wanted to do something, the other two computers would say, oh, you want to do this, then they would vote. So basically majority rules, or all three together, would make the decision and do something. This prevented this problem of what if in fact you have an error made by a machine, and that would bring the shuttle down. So this forwards to Tesla, because right now Tesla's having a challenge with crashes for their vehicles. We're right now at a pace of one crash a week, usually I think with Autopilot 2, but it doesn't matter. In general, there's a crash occurring, and there have been attempts to sort of replicate the problems that customers talked about prior to the crash, and they were unable to find that error in the software. And I believe that, or it's my belief that they're suffering this fate. Now, so I bring this up as a challenge because I think in the future what will end up happening is that, for example, if you have a multi-million dollar fighter from the US government, they actually have this redundancy. And as computers get cheaper, I think we're all in our cars going to have this computer redundancy as we rely on computers more and we're flying by wire, etc. So I wanted to note this to you because one of the options that will soon become available on most manufacturers, including Tesla, is you can pay $20,000 and have redundancy for all of the computers that you're running. And I think that redundancy will really help reduce the number of errors, potential accidents, etc. But right now, it's just not cost effective to do that. But I do believe it is a major challenge that's occurring. The next sort of iteration of articulating this challenge involves Tesla is now having something called what I call the revenge of the robots. And what this means is that it's been announced that Tesla is now crowdsourcing solutions for robots that are not performing very well. So for the average person, and I'll slow down because I know I have a plane above me here. I agree, it's a great view, but there is a shortcoming, which is we're in the flight path of planes landing at Reagan Airport. So basically what happens is if you buy a $600,000 robot, you can, if the robot doesn't behave properly, you can call up the manufacturer and say, excuse me, sir, the robot's not working well, we want a new one, or send your guys out to fix it. The problem you have though in Tesla's case is that Tesla is making an effort to go what I call off script. So they're actually introducing program or activity for those robots that go beyond the specs of manufacturer. So they are unable to get support for the new stuff they're doing to those robots. And so as a result, they're having certain robots that are not performing properly, and their goal is to use crowdsourcing or non-Tesla or manufacturer employees to help identify what the problem is and fix it. And I have to admit, this is the first time I've heard of a manufacturer of a hardware item actually going to crowdsourcing to try to solve a problem like this. It's innovative, interesting, and I think it shows some of the problems that they're having in the manufacturing process right now, if they're trying to address it in this fashion. The other thing that I wanted to note is, in our first segment, we just talked about the NASA problem. So let's randomly say Tesla has 500 robots on the factory floor, right? Each of those robots are performing functions to produce that car. Well, if on the schedule we described, one out of every, let's say, 50 or 100,000 iterations of its work, it screws up. You now have a sense for how many defects are being introduced to the production process by a robot, and you may not know when that defect occurs. So I think this allows us to really understand the potential for defects to show up, and not be discovered, and hence you might end up with a defect in your car that even Tesla didn't know about because the robot malfunctioned once and then didn't the next time. And so you now have a vehicle that's moving with maybe a minor defect that, you know, they find out later that has to be repaired. But it allows you to sort of anticipate, you know, what's going on potentially with a vehicle. The other thing I should note to you is if you have a laptop or any other computer, have you ever noticed that you'll be doing a function and all of a sudden you've done the function numerous times and it doesn't do the function one time? You'll reboot and everything is fine again and you're good. There's an example of what I mean about the NASA/SpaceX challenge. The machines will simply, maybe it's a software issue, maybe it's a hardware issue, it only does it every blue moon. But the problem is, for human beings that are just sitting at a computer, that one screw up is not a big deal. You can reboot. But if you have hundreds of these machines all linked up and trying to produce a car, it introduces problems. So I think that this is an illustration of why it is that Toyota has elected to have approximately the same amount of robots now as they did 10 or 15 years ago, because human beings sort of are more reliable than robots from this angle. This also answers an interesting point, which is, answers an interesting point because the CEO of GM actually made an effort to create a very automated factory like this. And so what they ended up with is that factory, even though the factory had fewer employees in it and it was robots, they had this problem where there would be these random errors that happen and the robots would behave badly. So you ended up with a greater amount of issues that might pop up, and you have to fix the cars at the end. So what they found was the initial manpower for these robotic factories was lower, but when you you had the potential and you introduced all of these potential problems that popped up, you had to have an after staff to fix all those defects. And so most of the people in the auto industry sort of gave up this effort. And it'll be interesting to see if in the next iteration of the Model 3 factory, there's an effort to roll back the degree of automation, even though they're trying to fix what they currently have. Because the Model S wasn't similarly automated, and we don't hear about all these shutdowns. And basically, the more human being, less automation did that. But it was a really good goal as to why they went to that degree of automation, which is to lower cost. I'm kind of concerned, interested here, because the third part of what I wanted to talk about is challenges that they're having with Autopilot 2 or AP2. And the issue is that Tesla elected to go to 8 cameras, sonar, and 14 sensors. So now you have all this data from those different entities being fed in and are part of the decision-making process that goes on as the car is moving. And so when we look at the fact that we're seeing these sort of accidents that are occurring pretty much on a weekly basis right now, we're seeing at least one or two accidents. And this is including, I think, 90% of the accidents we're seeing are from Autopilot 2, which is the Tesla-driven system without use of Mobileye. I'm sort of concerned that, we want you to be healthy. And so, noting some of the challenges that computers can introduce is probably a good idea. So I'm gonna move towards closing out and do our view as we usually do. Jerry, thanks for the comments on there. I think there are solar flares and other things that can occur that introduce challenges to the process. Sort of review. Well, our next show will be on Thursday. Hopefully we'll have, some new items to cover. We like to roam into zones that have not been covered previously. And we have some new items that I think you guys will enjoy. Please, we could use your help on Patreon if possible. $1 or $2 a month would definitely help us get towards our goal of new camera equipment. Number two, I'd also like to request that you please like, because that like affects how we're ranked relative to other information being provided on Tesla. And three, like and subscribe if you truly enjoyed what we're presenting. We're gonna finish up today with a look at the Alexandria area here. And tschüss, mach's gut, au revoir, tschüss, German, mach's gut, au revoir, French, favel, which is Dutch that I learned yesterday. Choda Hafez, Farsi, Lahitrot, Hebrew, and enough respect, walk good, man. And have a great day, and good to see you, Jerry. Thanks for getting up early and joining us once again.